And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Welcome to Sounds of Revival, a program and teaching ministry calling for the church to hear and respond to the sounds of revival, which are calling us back to our first love and back to our place of holiness and dominion in the earth. Sounds of Revival is brought to you by Greater Love International Church and Revival Center, located here in the city of Indianapolis at 6433 East Washington Street, where the pastor and founder is Bishop Perry E. Jackson. And now, Sounds of Revival.
Welcome to our program today, Sounds of Revival, brought to you by Perry Jackson Ministries and Greater Love International Church and Revival Center. I'm excited today because God has some good news for us. Isaiah chapter 59, Isaiah talks about the fact that God has brought something new into the world today, and it's now being brought to us. We are not missing out on God's new thing that He's doing in the world today, especially in the body of Christ. But before we go into the world today and tell you about that good news, we have a song that psalmist Lois Foster is going to sing for us today. She writes her own songs, and the song she's going to sing today is "I Don't Just Love You." She's talking about God, and let's hear what the psalmist has to say to us, and then we'll be right back.
There are times I've sat and thought of and I don't know what to do. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I'm so in love with you. There are times I sought the love of man. I'd given my best. Then when all was said and done, man could care less. When I think of how you've loved me and your love won't ever end, I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. I don't just love you, Lord. I'm so in love with you. When I think of how you've loved me and your love won't ever end, you've been my confidant and my closest friend. I can't
Amen. What a beautiful song. I don't just love you. That's wonderful because God expects us to love him. He said in the book of St. Luke, chapter 10, verse number 27, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your strength, and all of your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. So thank God for the opportunity and this dispensation of grace to love God all the way, not just part of the way. 1 John 3:18, the Bible said this, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. That kind of parallel the scripture that the Bible talks about in the book of James chapter 1. It talks about the fact that faith without works is dead. Love without works is dead. So we always want to grow in our love for God. Matter of fact, the Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, Paul prayed a prayer that the love of God's people would grow. It's wonderful to have love, but love has to grow. So Paul prayed a very interesting prayer, Ephesians chapter 3, verse number 14. He says, I bow my knees unto the God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant unto you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in your inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Note, Paul prayed that you would know, we would know as God's people, the depth, the length, the height of the love of God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 12, Paul prayed a prayer for the church in Thessalonica. He said, the Lord makes you to increase and abound in love, one toward another and toward all men. So the Bible lets us know that love is given, but it has to be. Let's go at 1 Thessalonians 3:12 again. The Lord makes you to increase, grow, and abound in love, one toward another and toward all men. So love can grow. Amen. Love has to develop. Because Paul said, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, when I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, and I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. So we can put away childish love and we can really grow in our love for him. And people, that is so important to get more of the love of God working on the inside of us, to display the love of God. Because Jesus did say, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have love one to another. Love will define who you are in Christ Jesus. Love separates the sheep from the goats. Not your works, not what you do, not your gifts, not your talents, but love really tells exactly who you are in Christ. As a matter of fact, that's part of the subject that we're going to use today, spiritual goats and sheep. Spiritual goats or sheep. And one thing in the natural realm, or actually the spiritual realm, when God talks about goats and sheep, he is really defining even Christians. There are Christians who exemplify and display goat spirits because they don't obey God. Therefore, we have been called to display the nature of Almighty God, which is the nature of sheep. So sometimes we look upon being goats as being people who are basically sinners. But no, the Bible talks about there are Christians who are carnal-minded, Christians who are rebellious, Christians who resist God, Christians who act just like goats. Amen. When God speaks to them, they have to think about it 5 or 6 days to decide if they want to obey him or not. But the Bible did say in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22, 23, and 24, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? For to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness as iniquity and idolatry. He was addressing God's people. Let's stop there a moment. Remember the subject, spiritual sheep and spiritual goats. So God says sometimes his people can be rebellious, glory to God, and they can be very unattentive to his voice. But Paul pleads with the Christians to be obedient to God and to not draw back. On many occasions from throughout the New Testament, Jesus talking about God's people, and then Paul and the apostles talking about God's people. Make sure that we are not exemplifying the spirit of goats rather than sheep. I know that this is kind of a hard thing to digest sometimes, but if we want the truth, the Bible says, St. John chapter 8, verse 32, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. What does that mean? God has truth that he wants us all to recognize about ourselves. So most time Christians, when they think about goats, they think about that sinner man out there. But really there is a, thank you, Jesus, an attitude that is in us. It's in the soul, man. Let's look at the chart here to get a better understanding of what I'm saying. We're going to charge it. Okay, when you were born again, remember your spirit man was born again, the soul man, James chapter 1 and verse 21, receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Remember that? So the soul is being saved. Paul said that on more than one occasion. The soul is being saved. The spirit man is saving and is being saved. The spirit man is saved. The soul man is being saved. And the body, he just follows along. Glory to God. Because we know that he's temporal. But he is a big player while you're in this life. He can be a great distraction. So he has to be brought under subjection to the Holy Spirit also. But what we're saying here, the soul man can be likened to a spiritual goat. Amen. He had that attitude. He doesn't want to go along with the good shepherd. He's always pulling back, always trying to distract you, always trying to deter you, always trying to water down the truth of God. Oh, yes, he's there. I know that's a shocking terminology to use when you're talking about saved people, but there's that there's a nature, there is a presence in us that has to be conquered and overcome and subdued. Glory to God. Many times we talk about conquering, overcoming, and subduing the devil, but that pride man, that goat that's present in the lives of God's born-again people has to be subdued on a daily basis, taken care of, as putting him in his place. So, again, I was kind of shocked that God would tell me to use goats and sheep paralleling his people, how that there's a spirit, a wrong spirit, can arise in God's people. Man, it is written throughout the Bible how people who were once sweetly saved, people who followed God, somehow, some way they got off into bad doctrine. The Bible even talks about Christians being carried away with doctrines of devils. Glory to God. People taking the word of God and making it say what they wanted to say. For example, what we call cheap grace. Basically, they say, well, anything we do, we can sin, we can lie, we can steal, we can commit adultery, we can commit fornication, we can commit homosexuality. Anything goes because grace will cover you. That's not true. Amen. Grace will help you and grace will lift you, but grace has a point where it stops and you have to be accountable for your sins. Glory to God. So that's one doctrine of devils, that the soul man, he loves that because then there's no accountability. And also remember, when you talk about the soul man and this goat nature, that's prideful nation that wants to do things its way. But you know, the Bible did say in the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verse number 8, 9, and 10, it says, God says, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. As the heavens are higher above the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So God's ways are so much different than ours. So we have to learn the ways of God. We have to learn kingdom principles. We have to learn how to think like God thinks. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 16, the Bible said, we have the mind of Christ. But don't misunderstand that. We have it as long as we are seeking the mind of Christ. Glory to God. Go back to Isaiah chapter 55, verse number 6 and 7. It says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 7 says this, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened. So, old child of God, when you walk with him, going back to 1 Corinthians 2:16, we have the mind of Christ. You have it as long as you keep on seeking him. St. John chapter 8, verse number 32, the Bible said, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. What does that mean? If you continue to seek my word, continue to learn of me. So we are saying that God has many things he wants to teach us, but yet we must be available and we must have a teachable spirit so that we can be spiritual sheep. I like that. I want to be a spiritual sheep. I don't want to be classified as a rebellious, unteachable child of God, son of God, because remember, let me just remind you, throughout Genesis to Revelation, God talks about, not only does he talk about sinners, but he talks about sons of God and children of God. You have, and how God, but then God classifies his children, even born again people. He classifies them as carnal-minded saints and spiritual-minded saints. To be spiritually minded is life and peace, but to be carnally minded is death. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 8. So now just slow down and just let our minds zero in on the fact again. I have to be redundant. Now, when he talks about carnal mind, he's not talking about sinners. He's talking about saints. Paul begs and almost pleads. As a matter of fact, on one occasion, Paul said in Romans chapter 12, I beseech you therefore. By the way, that word beseech, our common vernacular word, I beg you. I beseech you, I beg you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Look at verse number 2 of that Romans chapter 12. Now watch, he's talking to saints. And be not, talk about saved people, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. Don't go back doing what you used to do. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed, changed by the renewing of your mind, by the word of God and by being taught the word of God. Be transformed, not conformed. He might say, what is going on here? You've been born again, but now you're going in the wrong direction. She said, don't go that way. Don't be conformed to this world. The Bible says that love not the world, neither the things. He's talking to saints again. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, 1 John 2:14 and 15, if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Glory to God. So if you love the world, then you have lost the love of God. Love not the world, neither the thing that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, still talking to Christians, the lust of the eye and the pride of life, which is not of the Father, but is of the world. And then he goes on to say, the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Admonishing Christians, don't fall back into lust. Don't fall back into your worldly nature. Don't fall back into that goat nature. G-O-A-T, goat nature that God delivered you from. Protect that sheep nature. Protect that sheep mentality. So you have to protect what God gives you because Satan can defile you. Glory to God, and steal that gift that God has given you, steal that nature, steal that love, steal that joy, steal your peace. He's a thief, St. John chapter 10 and verse 10, the thief cometh not before to steal, kill, and to destroy. Jesus said, but I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 11, I'm going to give you another scripture that talks about how Satan can take from you what God gives you, that sweet, gentle, loving, kind, heavenly disposition that God gives you. If you're not careful, Satan can make you, he can turn you, and you can be everything but that. You have to protect what God gives you. You have to develop it. You have to prayerfully guard it. So Revelation chapter 3, verse 11, Jesus said this, talking to the church of God, one of the seven churches, he said, behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take your crown. What God gives you, hold on to it, because Satan is coming after it with vengeance. Yes, he is. The Bible says, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, 9, and 10, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Amen? Now, he already has the sinner. He's talking to saints here. Seeking whom he may devour. So, Satan wants to devour you. But the Bible said, the remedy for that, he said, the next verse, whom resist steadfast in the faith. You have to resist that devil again, because he will devour you. Amen. Again, you will be transformed. Instead of going from glory to glory and from strength to strength, you will be transformed going backwards. And Paul talked about folks going backwards in the book of Hebrew, glory to God, chapter 10. He said, we are not of them who draw back into perdition, who go back. That word perdition means we are not of them who draw back into perdition. And that word perdition means destruction. We don't go back into destruction, but of them who believe to the saving of the soul. Saving, that soul has to continually go forward. He has to go. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 18, the Bible said this, the path of the just is as the shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. So what does your Christian life look like? What does my Christian life look like? Proverbs 4, 18, we have to go forward. And by the way, there's no in-between. If you're not moving forward, you're automatically going backward. That's just the way it is. I know people don't see it like that, but that's how God sees it, and that's how it really happens, people. If you're not pressing forward and not making progress in God, it may not look like anything bad is happening, but you're going backwards in the sight of God. So therefore, we're going forward in God. Proverbs 4:18, the path of the just is as the shining light that shineth more and more and more unto the perfect day. God wants to take you somewhere in him. God wants to grow you up. God wants to make you, if you're sweet, he wants to make you sweeter. If you're good, he wants to make you better. If you're kind, he wants to make you kinder. If you're loving, he wants to make you more loving. If you're gentle, he wants to make you more gentle. If you're patient, he makes you more patient. The sky is the limit, because God can take you to a place of maturity in him that you can actually take on the very nature of God. And when people see you, they can see Jesus. That's our goal in Christianity. So the subject was spiritual goats and spiritual sheep. And let us try to pursue God, the things of God. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, 23, again, it exemplifies the nature of a sheep. Remember, Galatians 5, 22, 23, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, faith, temperance. Against us, there's no law, the Bible says. So let us understand that we have to focus our attention on God and pursue those things which are of a godly nature, because they just, once you're born again, being godly, being holy, being gentle, being kind, it just doesn't come natural. It comes supernatural, because you know we are naturally unkind, naturally angry, naturally selfish. Yeah. So you have to, as it were, any dead fish can float down the stream, but it takes a live fish to go against the current. And that's what happened when you are born again Christians. You have to go against the current. What's that current? I'm not talking about the current of the devil, the current of the world, but the very current of your very soul, man, that's kicking and fighting and screaming all the way, trying to get its own way, the soul man. Again, Paul said, in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good things. You can win the war, but you just have to understand who the opponent is. Amen. The enemy is in us sometimes. It's the soul man, but God has given you a way to overcome him. Amen. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. God's word can help you overcome that that goat that seems to try to come back in all of us. Amen. All right, our time is up for today, and may God bless you, and we will talk to you next time. God bless.
Sounds of Revival was brought to you by Perry Jackson Ministries and Greater Love International Church and Revival Center in Indianapolis at 6433 East Washington Street. Worship Sunday at 10:30 a.m. and 6 p.m. Tuesdays at 7:30 p.m. For directions or to receive your free bi-monthly newsletter, call 317-796-0938. Or email jackson-perry@att.net. To request today's program or sermon on CD or DVD, please send an offering of any amount to Perry Jackson Ministries, P.O. Box 26891, Indianapolis, Indiana 46226. Ask for the offer number on the screen.